This frail silhouette has become very familiar to us all. For the past half century, he's been the symbol of the fight against all injustice. We all know the Abbé Pierre, but who amongst us knows the man?
My family name is Henri Grouès, and I was born in 1912. My mother comes from the Beaujolais area. My father was, for us, an exceptional man, although very simple and modest.
The family Grouès lived in Lyon. Henri was the fifth in a family of eight. Religion was very important to the Grouès family. Little Henri was said to be very turbulent and strong-headed, but also sensitive. Every Sunday, the father would disappear, with no one knowing where he was going. One day, he takes two of his sons with him, Henri and Léon. The future Abbé Pierre discovers then that his father belongs to a group of people, the hospital helpers. They look after the poor and the tramps in the outskirts of Lyon.
This was certainly one of the events that marked my life at about 10 years of age.
One particular thing attracts little Henri: adventures in faraway countries. Exotic images of missionary workers leave a strong impression on him.
On Thursdays or Sundays, when the weather was not nice and it rained, and I could not play outside, I used to ask my mother for 2 or 3 francs to go to the museum, where I would spend hours looking at and reading books.
In this old museum, a new vocation was born. Henri decided to tell his father.
I was about 12 when I told him I wanted to become a missionary. After a moment of surprise, he says, "It will be very hard for your mother and for myself, but we shall be very proud of you."
When he has to be operated on for appendicitis, Henri enters a clinic, and it's within these white walls that he learns to know love for the first time.
In the room next to mine at the hospital, there was a girl of about my age who I had met a few times. We started writing little notes to each other, and the nurse would fetch and carry them to us both. It was obviously of little consequence, but my heart had been taken.
Throughout his life, the Abbé Pierre has been dogged by ill health. Already as a child, he was not spared this experience. Very often, he had to spend periods in bed, and during these periods, read a vast amount of books. As he is 13, he discovers an author who's going to make him put into question all his convictions: René Descartes.
I was absolutely fascinated by the total rigor of Cartesian thought. You cannot accept anything until you have seen justification, causes, and proof. And it suddenly crossed my mind that if I had been born in a different environment, I would behave differently. I would dress differently. This was the absolute doubt that Descartes had instilled within me.
This doubt was to last, and to put into question the religious life of Henri Grouès. He decides to give up his dreams of becoming a missionary and enters the uncertain world of adolescence. In the 20s, the Scout movement came into its own in France. Henri belongs to the first troop that is created in Lyon and convinces some of his brothers to join him. This answers his need for action and for sharing, but his need for the absolute and for mysticism has not yet been satisfied. At Easter in 1927, he joins a pilgrimage to Assisi. In a few hours, all his life will be transformed. Nowadays, his closest friends still repeat that in order to understand the Abbé Pierre, you must know what happened to him in Assisi. He will forever refer back to it.
For me, Assisi has been the most important moment in my life.
St. Francis of Assisi was born in 1182 in a middle-class family. He was marked by a series of personal experiences, in particular the encounter with Christ, who appeared to him as a living person, compelling him to leave everything and go out to preach the word of God to all creatures. That day in 1927, in the Carcery Convent, the same where St. Francis had lived, Henri Grouès had a double revelation.
As we arrived, we heard our guide, in French, explain about the Carcery, and after a while, I went away from the group across an alley along the mountain in the forest, and two inner events happened then, which I cannot express fully in words. Suddenly I was hit by the clear concept that during adoration, as our guide had said, there was communion with the whole universe, even if you were alone in the forest, a feeling that you cannot get in any other way. Another illumination struck my mind in the light of what I had heard about St. Francis's life, that only through adoration you get a clear understanding of the intensity of action that you have to undertake.
This discovery of what adoration means is going to be vital for the future of this young man. All his life, he'll be able to draw enough strength from this to get into action.
The boy that came down from the Carcery was no longer the same that had gone up to it. It was absolutely clear I was no longer the same person. The decision had been taken that I would spend the rest of my life within the family of St. Francis.
After having got his baccalaureate, Henri becomes a novice. This novitiate will last for 7 years. 7 years of study, prayer, and discomfort. He lives in a 6 square meter cell where it freezes in the winter. This was very hard for his health. In 1938, when he was 26, he's ordained priest, but his superiors start wondering whether they can keep in the monastery this young monk because of his fragile health. Henri is made to accept that he should leave the monastery to join the normal clergy. He's sent to the Grenoble region. But it's 1939. War breaks out. Henri Grouès is called up, like all young Frenchmen. On the Alsace front, the winter is hard. Henri Grouès, soldier, becomes ill with pleurisy.
I had not experienced war in any way. I'd not even heard one gunshot so far. I was put in an ambulance and carried to a tent. I don't know where. It was May and the war proper was just starting. From stage to stage, I was getting further away from war and towards Narbonne.
The armistice was signed. Hitler's victory was complete. France was cut in two and the exodus was in full swing. In Vichy, Pétain establishes a government of collaboration and tells the country to expect terrible trials and suffering. Abbé Grouès goes back to Grenoble Cathedral. For him, it looks as if war is over, but that is not true at all.
For me, it was no longer war with machine guns, but clandestine and secret war. Vichy had given orders upon the request of the Nazis that French gendarmes would arrest French people and transport them in French railway wagons. There were arrests carried out in Free France by the French gendarmes on the orders of Darlan. I was fully propelled into the war. 2 or 3 days later, I can't remember, I was in Paris and two men came to knock at my door in the middle of the night. They were crying and told me We are Jews. We live on the same floor. And when we came back this evening, the neighbors told us to hide ourselves. So I let them in, put them to sleep, one on the settee and one in an armchair. And in the morning I went to fetch bread, milk, and whatever I could lay my hands upon to give them breakfast. And then I remembered that there was a nuns' community, Ladies of Zion. I went to see the Mother Superior, who indicated that she already sheltered people, thus threatening everybody's safety. However, she added, if you are going to the mountains, you can help me. I am going to call the sister who knows how to make false papers.
In order to improve his health, the young priest had enrolled for a mountain course and decides to lead groups of refugees into Switzerland, very near there.
I took the first trip via Chamonix, where I met a guide who was a great friend of mine. And he led the first trip on one of the first crazy expeditions on a path which he considered to be absolutely safe, up to 3,200 meters, which leads to the tip of a mountain pass between two glaciers and down to Martigny on the Swiss side. We got to the top, tied by ropes, with a group of about 10 people. The guide first, and me last. And at that point he said, from here onwards, you are free. I was overwhelmed.
The network created by the Abbé Grouès allowed about 100 people to cross into Switzerland. At that moment, the Abbé Pierre, who had just turned 30, starts a new career as a false document provider.
Friends who were civil servants provided me with blank documents from stocks in the prefecture and the police station, the blanks for identity cards and passports. And we obtained a machine to be able to put absolutely authentic stamps on them. And in order to age these documents, I found the best way was to rub them on the corner of the table so that they would not look new anymore. This period was hard for my health because during the day, I had to put up appearances and lead a normal life as a priest, looking after the children, giving catechism lessons, whilst at night I would do this work. And for about 6 months, I did not sleep for more than 4 hours a night.
The war intensifies, and all young Germans were being called up. The Reich lacks sufficient men to run the country, invents the STO, which is the obligatory work service in France. It was set up with the collaboration of the Vichy government to send young Frenchmen to work in German factories. In the Grenoble region, the young men who do not wish to join up go in their dozens to the Vercors area, to the Maquis. Abbé Grouès, who publishes a clandestine paper, the Independent Patriotic Union, contributes to its organization by establishing links between the various Maquis groups and the leaders of the resistance. From now on, Henri Grouès will never be the Abbé Grouès again. His identity was changed for the first time in a long series of changes.
I became Georges Houdin, the famous magician 100 years ago. And I took that as my new identity. I started organizing crossings across the Pyrenees. On one occasion, coming back from one of them, I was arrested.
The false Georges Houdin managed to escape his German escort, gets himself to Lourdes and over the Pyrenees. Arrested by the Spanish police for illegal entry into Spain, he's taken to Madrid by train. It is the 6th of June 1944. The Normandy landings are just starting. In Madrid, the authorities decide to hand over Georges Houdin to the Canadian Red Cross.
The Canadian Red Cross fabricated a false identity. I still have the papers now when I became Sir Harry Barlow, a Canadian pilot who had been shot down over France.
He was flown to Gibraltar and from there as a clandestine passenger on an American aircraft to Algiers. Here, his identity is changed once more.
The evening just after having arrived, I was taken to the local radio and asked to talk about the fighting in the Vercors. And I said, "You must not mention my name because I have many brothers and sisters in France and this will put them in danger." One of those present, without really thinking, said, "We shall call you Abbé Pierre." And that name has stuck with me ever since. And even on my passport, my name is Henri Grouès, called Abbé Pierre.
In France, it is now the liberation. In January 1945, the Abbé Pierre returns to Paris, having become, without trying to, one of the most striking emblems of the resistance. At the first legislative elections organized after liberation, he's persuaded to stand for parliament. He's elected on the first round for the MRP, the Popular Republican Movement. In 1947, the Abbé Pierre moves into a large neglected property in disrepair in Neuilly-Plaisance in the outskirts of Paris. Between two sittings at the Palais Bourbon, he restores it, turning it into a youth hostel, and starts lodging families because the homeless are numerous after the war. He calls the house Emmaus, which is where, according to the Gospels, Christ restored hope to two of his disciples after his resurrection. 1949 is the real starting point of the Emmaus community, when the Abbé Pierre meets the man who will become the first companion, Georges Leguay. Leguay was desperate, imprisoned for murder and then paroled after 20 years. He decided to commit suicide.
He is there in front of me, telling me about his despair, and I told him I could not say anything else. "Georges, what you have suffered is terrible, but I can do nothing for you, as I am full of debts. Everything I receive, I spend, and I cannot see what I can give you. There is nothing I can give you. However, you who are about to die, you are free with all your body, and therefore, before you kill yourself, you could come and help me. I need you. There are mothers who are crying on their children in cellars. They need us. So instead of giving him something, I was asking him to give something to me. This man, who was desperate and wanted to finish his life, suddenly discovered there was something he could do and a reason for hope. And he said, yes."
The third actor in the birth of Emmaus is a woman, Lucie Coutaz. The Abbé Pierre had met her during the war. After liberation, she agrees to work for him. "Without her," says the Abbé Pierre, "nothing would have been possible." The beginning is difficult. The center in Neuilly-Plaisance is over full. But with the help of Georges, the Abbé builds shelters and even houses in the grounds. And it is Lucie Coutaz who handles the finances. The first Emmaus companions are no choir boys. However, these hardened men show they can respond to the trust this Abbé, who's quite different from any other, put in them.
It is because of these men, who were certainly not an elite, the ones that followed were all characters and kept on fighting amongst themselves after drinking. So we had to solve all this to start building respect and companionship.
Life runs faster and faster. There are more and more homeless coming. The Abbé Pierre buys more land and the companions build on them, very often illegally.
I often went ahead without taking any account of the law, following the law of life, which requires action. And to those who would tell me that I was not quite legal, I would answer, "I merely anticipate what the law will come to say later on, because you will be obliged to create a legal framework for this to happen."
In 1952, the Abbé Pierre does not stand for parliament again. He intends to give himself fully to the fight on behalf of the excluded. However, without his parliamentary salary, he'll soon not have sufficient money to feed his people.
The day I left Parliament, the tap was turned off. One evening, Mlle Coutaz came to tell me that there was no money for bread. I told her that we would certainly find the means to do something and quickly went to a printer. I asked him to print a few hundred sheets, and I went to the Boulevard Saint-Germain to beg. I came back to the house in Neuilly Plaisance, woke up Mlle Coutaz, and emptied my pockets in front of her. Mlle Coutaz was very direct and burst into a wild fury. And she said, "What you have done is totally unacceptable. You can do better than that." And I said, "Yes, but what else should I do?"
The companions are just as unhappy about what he has done as Mademoiselle Coutaz, to find that the Abbé Pierre has gone out begging on their behalf. One of them, Auguste, makes a suggestion to recycle old paper, cloths, metals, and to go and empty cellars and lofts of items that people no longer need. This is how the rag pickers of Emmaus were born.
Within 4 to 6 weeks, we managed to get enough to survive and to have enough to finance those who were building the houses.
Pour financer les travailleurs qui continuent à construire des maisons.
In winter 1954, the temperature goes down to minus 20. It is the coldest winter ever recorded in France. People are dying in poor lodgings. Some are found frozen dead, even on the pavements of Paris. That is when Abbé Pierre launches an appeal on the air.
We have to make certain that there is immediate shelter. We cannot allow people to die in the cold, and by our current behavior, we show ourselves to be worse than savages.
The Hotel Rochester in the Rue de la Boétie becomes the Abbé Pierre's headquarters. The 5,000 blankets he's been requesting arrive in one day. Train and metro stations become shelters for the homeless on the order of the prefecture. On a field behind the Pantheon, a big military tent is set up.
Cette nuit du 2 février 1954, personne ne dormira dans la rue.
Abbé Pierre becomes famous. The press makes him a hero. His call for help has gathered 25 million francs. The Council of Ministers announced that 100 million francs have been voted for building urgent new accommodation. Without waiting for it, the Abbé Pierre starts building 48 dwellings. He also starts building in Pont au Corbeau. This project can go ahead thanks to a vast organization, in receipt of a lot of subsidies and financed by the banks. It is the Emmaus HLM, Council Houses. By the end of the 20th century, it manages more than 10,000 dwellings. Emmaus is expanding in many countries, where many more Emmaus communities are created. As ever, the Abbé Pierre goes everywhere he is called, even if it is now across the oceans. Emmaus has become very big, but yet it is fragile, and this becomes apparent in 1963 when the Abbé Pierre goes on a trip to South America. He's 51 years old. The Abbé Pierre could not foresee that during this trip to Latin America he would be shipwrecked during a crossing from Buenos Aires to Montevideo. The ship caught fire after hitting a wreck in thick fog on the sandbanks of the estuary. Abbé Pierre helps people to get to safety. 40 out of the 400 passengers lose their lives. Saved by his life jacket, he floated all night, often losing consciousness, and was picked up in the morning after having thought that his last moment had come.
Very simple thoughts had come to me during the night. First, that when you put your hand into those of the poor and tried your best, it is not possible that in the last moment of your life, God does not put his hand into yours. And that thought filled my heart and gave me great peace. And the other thought was that death, after all, was just a long-awaited meeting with a friend.
The Abbé Pierre realizes the fragility of what he had been building. He's the only one to know all aspects of it. he decides to give the movement in France a proper structure. That is when Emmaus France and Emmaus International are created. He is a man of flesh and life, a man with a lot of emotions. His outbursts of anger are formidable. He's the opposite of a man who normally invites respect, but he invites also much more than that, admiration. Tempted by retirement, but constantly attracted by action, he goes on fighting the same old enemies. Injustice, indifference, intolerance.
I am not going to leave this pavement for as long as this has not been done. Never in his whole life will Henri Grouès, called Abbé Pierre, have given up a fight.
Thank you.